Hi everybody, this is Linda, and welcome back to my channel. So if you're watching this, you are probably either working on an application and you intend to add Google authentication to it, or you're thinking about it and you're just doing some research right now. So I am here to help you decide which type of client you need to make on Google Developer Console in order to add Google authentication to your application. Over the years, I have seen a lot of questions on Stack Overflow, and they always come back to a user creating the incorrect type of credentials for the code they're using or for the application type that they're using. And I thought I would save you some time and we would just go through it together and I'd explain to you how it is that you go about deciding which type of client you need to create. And then at the end of this video, I'm going to give you some pointers into finding sample code that you will need in order to add this authentication to your system. The issue being that most of the Google APIs do not have samples for each of the methods of authentication for every language, because that would be a lot of documentation for them. And I can't go through with you for every programming language the sample code that you're going to need. But I can point you in the direction of finding working sample code for that type of authentication for your language. You may end up having to work it out. And if you do have any issues, please feel free to post it up on Stack Overflow. I may not know every programming language, but when it comes to working with the Google APIs and the Google client libraries, I'm pretty good at being able to figure out what is your issue and helping you, even in Java and Python, which I haven't actually professionally coded in myself. I can still help you figure it out. So here's the plan. I'm going to ask you some questions. And as I ask the questions, if all of a sudden you hit one that says, hey, that's me, that's my application, and that's one I want to use, then what you're going to do is you can stop there, or by all means, you know, I love the view count and the extended view length. You're welcome to watch the entire video. But once you find the one that you think is you, then you can just kind of scroll to the end and catch up on the pointers of how to find the sample code. So it's up to you how you want to do. If you want to watch the entire video, I'd love it if you watch the entire video. But I'm not going to ask you to do that. But you might learn something if you learn about, you might have another application later on and it might be good to know. So, but yeah, let's get started. So my first question is, the data you want to access, is it private data or is it public data? So do you know the difference? Private data is data that is owned by a user. My Google Drive data, it's mine. I own it. You can't access it without my permission. My Google Calendar is the same. You can't access it without my permission. But the YouTube videos that I upload to YouTube are technically public data. Anybody can access them. You don't need to be authorized. So, but how do you know which one it is? Sometimes it can be a little bit of a gray area with some of the Google APIs and some of the methods. It can be gray. So what you do is you go to the documentation page for the API and for the method you're looking for. Then you scroll down and you look for a section that says authorize. And this section, if it exists, means that you need to be authorized, and it will tell you exactly which scopes that you need to request of the user. And these are the scopes of permission that you need, the minimum scopes of permission that you need in order to access the data. For example, to access my Drive data, you would need a minimum of read access. You could also request write access, but those are two different scopes that would work for the same one. So basically, the easiest way to know is to just go and check the documentation. If it says I need authorize, then you need authorization. So you're going to have to use some form of authorization or OAuth too. But if it doesn't, then what you can use is something called an API key. You can go over to Google Developer Console, you create an API key, and this will give you access to public data, only public data. All it does is it identifies your application to Google so that they know who is making these calls, or rather, whose application is making these calls. So to my last question, you said that the data you want to access is in fact private user data. Okay, so my next question is, who owns this data? Is this data owned by users of your application? Or is this internal data that you, the developer, own? For example, do you have a directory up on Google Drive that you'd like to be able to upload some internal files to and maybe show them to your users or serve them to your users in some way? Do you have a Google Sheet that you want to be able to write to? Stuff like that. Internal static data for your actual application. If you said yes to that this is static data that your application would use and that you, the developer, or your company control, then what you can use is something called a service account. Service accounts are like dummy users. A service account technically has its own Google Drive account, has its own Google Calendar account, and probably a few more. So what you can do with a service account is that you can pre-authorize it to access certain data. For example, I can pre-authorize a service account to access a folder on my Google Drive account. And then when I run my application, my service account will automatically log in and have access to that data. I don't need the normal consent screen popping up and requesting access of the user. So service accounts are normally used for, you can use them for cron jobs, you can use them for microservices and stuff like that. It's something internal that you would use. But the elegant part about it is the fact that it does not need user intervention. You don't need to click on that web browser saying, yes, you can have access. It automatically has access. The only issue with service accounts is that Google has been making some changes over the last few years. Service accounts do not work with all Google APIs. For example, service accounts have, for example, never worked with YouTube or Blogger, to my knowledge. It just doesn't work. I have some theories as to why it doesn't work, but it doesn't work. And in recent years, Google has changed Gmail and Calendar so that you can only add service accounts if you have a G Suite account, which is what Google Workspace now. You have to set up the service account for domain-wide delegation on the service account. Unfortunately, I don't have access to a Workspace account anymore, so I haven't been able to create any tutorials for you on that yet. I intend to at some point, as soon as I get access to an account. So you just need to remember that service accounts don't work with every API. It does with some, and it's a little annoying, the change that they made to Google Calendar, but I can understand why they made that change. So just remember that when considering using a service account. Okay, to my previous example, you said that you were going to be accessing data that is owned by your users. So, which client do you create now? Well, now you actually need to use OAuth 2. You are going to need to pop up a consent window that asks the user, can I access your data? And the user will then be allowed to say yes or no by clicking on the accept button. So, my next question to you is, what type of application do you have? Are you creating a web application? PHP, ASP.NET Core, JavaScript. Will this application be hosted on a web server? If so, then you will need web browser credentials. If, on the other hand, you are going to be creating an installed application, something that will be run on a specific machine. For example, are you creating a cron job? Are you creating I don't know, maybe even a microservice? Are you creating a library, maybe? Windows Forms application. These types of things are installed applications. The application is run on a specific machine. Then you will need to create type desktop, other, native. Google has changed the name of this type of client so many times I've lost track. Go into Google Developer Console, try and create it. I think at the time of recording this video, I believe it now says desktop, but I'll have to check. Like I said, in the past few years, it has been called other, it's been called native. Just create that one. So what is the actual difference between these? Because you need to understand the difference between these. The difference between a web browser one and an installed one is that on an installed client, the code will cause the web browser window to pop up and request access on the machine it's running on. So if you try to use an installed application over on a web browser, it's going to open that window on the web server, which isn't going to work. With web browser credentials, it forces it to open the browser on the user's client, as in the user's, the person who's using it on their browser window on their machine. So that's basically the only difference, is where the browser window is opened. Okay, so you should now know which type of client you need. If it's public data, then you use an API key. If you're accessing internal data using an API that supports service accounts, you should probably be using a service account. Do you have a web application? Then you should be creating a web browser client. Are you creating an installed application? You should be creating an installed client. It's that simple. What type of data are you accessing? What type of application are you making? That's all you need to know. And you will save yourself so much grief. Now for the fun part. How to find the code that you need to use your client. As I mentioned before, not all of the Google APIs give examples for all types of authorization. Most of them only give examples for installed, as in console applications, which is extremely annoying because a lot of new developers, potentially like yourself, do not read, shocker, all of the text on the actual sample that says you're creating an installed client. And if you're creating a way, you know, they don't realize it. So, for example, most of the Google Drive samples that I am aware of created by Google, as far as I know, all of them, most of them, are only for console applications. They don't actually give you an example if you are creating a web application. So how do you find the code? The first place that you need to look is the GitHub project for your client library. All of the Google client libraries that I am aware of have projects on GitHub. For example, the Google APIs, .NET client library, the PHP client library, the Python client library, the Node.js one, and the JavaScript one are all on GitHub. Go over to the GitHub page for your client library, check the README. Most of them, if not all of them, have examples there, basic examples for authorization with a service account, with web, and with installed. Not all of them have it for using an API key, but honestly, adding an API key is normally very basic, and if you Google around, you will probably find an example on Stack Overflow. If that doesn't work, then what I recommend you do is check around the different APIs, because all you want is the authorization code, which means you can take a very decent example for Node.js service account from the Google Analytics reporting API documentation, and just take the authorization section and plug that in to the example for Node.js listing files, and it'll work. You just need the authorization chunk, and the authorization chunk is going to be the same from each API. The Google Analytics team have very good examples for web and service accounts, and they have a few for installed, and they even have one for client side. If you want an example in a specific language for installed, then as far as I know, the Drive team has it for almost every language that I could think of. They've got it for quite a few languages. I think all of their examples, like I said, they're installed. So as long as you're after an installed one, go check the Drive samples, because you're going to find it for Node.js, for JavaScript, for PHP, for Python. I don't think they have .NET, but I don't think many of them have created the .NET ones. That's why I do that. And then if that doesn't work, I recommend doing a Google. Just Google Drive API Python installed app. And normally you will come up with some examples on Stack Overflow that will lead you to being able to get it to work. And if you don't, post a question. I'll see if I can't help. Well, that's all for now, and I hope you enjoyed my first, I guess you would call, talking head type of video. And I hope you learned something, and I hope you avoid creating the incorrect type of client. I am going to leave you with one final note about web browser clients. If you are creating a server-sided web client, then you need to use a redirect URI. If you are creating client-side, for example, JavaScript, then you need to use the JavaScript origin. You do not need both. It's a one or the other type of thing. And the best way to figure out what your redirect URI is to not set it, get an error, and Google will tell you which one you should have put in there. That's my trick for you. I guess that's it for now. And I hope you enjoyed this video. And as always, I hope you consider giving me a like and subscribing, because this is a new channel and I'm trying to figure out whether or not you like this kind of content. And it helps me to know that, yeah, you're doing good, Linda, and you know, keep it up and we're learning something. So yeah, consider giving me a like and subscribing. I'd really appreciate it. You have a really great day, and I'll see you again for the next one. Bye.